Good evening. I'm Glenn Lowry, and I'm the director of the Museum of Modern Art, and I'm delighted to welcome you to what we hope is the first of a series of conversations in the public interest. And the idea behind this, to sort of convene a group of people to have a serious conversation about current and important issues, grew out of a conversation that Homi Bhabha and I had probably 6 or 7 months ago. And as you may know, Homi Bhabha is a Rothenberg professor of the humanities at Harvard and also the director of the Mahindra Humanities Center and senior advisor to the president of Harvard, and the titles go on, all of which is in your little flyer. We were talking about how the Museum of Modern Art and Harvard could work together to address topical issues. And so the thought was that by addressing important questions quickly, we could create a conversation that was in the public interest. And so tonight we begin with, in the public interest, Unequal Urbanisms, an idea that grew out of a brilliant exhibition curated by Pedro Gadaño, a curator in the Department of Architecture and Design here at the Museum of Modern Art, an exhibition that that addresses the larger question of unequal growth and the way in which megacities have developed and the question of tactical urbanisms. And that exhibition is up on our third floor. If you haven't seen it, I encourage you to do so. You will have seen a number of images from Tumblr that are pouring into the museum, encouraged by this exhibition to share local responses to tactical urbanisms. And what we hope is exhibitions like Unequal Growth, conversations like this, can really generate not only thinking, but action. And the Tumblr images are one form of action, and I hope all of you will create another form of action. And we're thrilled that we're joined by Gene Gang, the principal of Studio Gang, a brilliant architect based in Chicago, a great friend of this museum. She's participated in a number of our projects. And what we hope is to begin with a conversation among the four of us and then turn it over to all of you to ask questions. But if you have a burning question that occurs to you as we're talking, don't be shy. Although the format for this is puts a distance between us and all of you, we don't feel there's a distance. It may be a physical distance, but it's not a metaphoric distance at all. This is really meant to be a rich conversation. And I don't think there's a more important issue that any of us who either live in cities or think about cities can address than the way in which there's a kind of inherent inequality in our cities. And how do we, a socioeconomic inequality, a political inequality, a physical inequality, an intellectual inequality, we can go down the list of inequalities that inadvertently but very powerfully structure how we experience our urban environments. And we want to foreground that and start to think about what it means and how we might collectively address that. And so I thought we'd begin with Homi musing on this subject. And all I can say is you couldn't imagine a greater partner than Homi Bhabha, who has been a senior advisor to this museum and our program on contemporary and modern art perspectives, one of the greatest thinkers I know, and truly a great friend. So Homi, thanks so much for doing this with us.
Well, Glenn, thank you very much. You've, as always, been more generous than I deserve, but I'll lap it up. when Glenn asked me to come and work with him here on the CMAP program, I discovered a whole other side to my brain. And I have greatly enjoyed my engagement here. So when I thought of doing this program at the Humanities Center with my colleagues there, I thought that it would be wonderful to have two faces to the program, one in Cambridge, Mass, and the other one in New York. And so Glenn and I were talking, and I said, why don't we do something called In the Public Interest, where we would want to understand the changing nature of publics, the way in which the questions of diversity, questions of interest, questions of multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-belief systems seem to have reshaped the notion of the public. The notion of the public now is a very complex issue in any major public institution. When it thinks of outreach, has to think of issues that it never thought of before, both in terms of the complexity of the local situation, whether it's the city or the nation, but also internationally and globally. The exchanges, the interchanges have become so complex, the networks have become so thick and so rich, that the very concept of what is your public has changed. So we wanted to problematize the public, and then we wanted to problematize the notion of interest. For a long time, people thought they could represent their public interest through guilds or through committees or through political parties. Now we have other forms or other associative forms, affiliative forms of expressing one's interest. And of course, one might want to say that with the notion of an international civil society developing, with the concept of the of what we call the era of rights now, people seem to have a right to think of their interests in terms of rights. And indeed, if the wonderful, rich materials produced by Pedro for this event talks about the right to the city, and that is something that I think, one of the issues I think we should collectively discuss, the right to the city. What does that mean? Can you really have a right to a city, or does that right have to be broken up into different kinds of rights and interests, different sorts of associations? What do we mean when we talk about the right to a city? So I think that might be one issue that comes out of our discussion, and I thought I might put it on the table very quickly, because I do believe that both cultural industries and cultural institutions come together now to make us think very productively of what we might call cultural citizenship. Not simply legal citizenship or political citizenship or social citizenship. Those were the three very conventional political labelings of citizenship, but a new sense of cultural citizenship to work with the notion of the right to the city or the right to one's own locality. it struck me, too, that unequal urbanisms, uneven urbanities, tactical urbanism, these phrases, these terms are in themselves very interesting because they all signify a certain imbalance. There's something in each of them, there is a certain kind of imbalance, whether it's a spatial one, as you said, Glenn, or it's an imbalance of opportunity, or it's a socioeconomic imbalance. But what seems to me to be interesting about this exhibition and the materials around which it was built is that the idea is not that we can find a perfect balance. We can't find a perfect balance. Therefore, all of politics is about the balance of power because it's actually about the imbalance of power. So we're continually negotiating balance for equity or for fairness or for environmental well-being. So I thought we might actually think about the way in which, from sort of negative conditions, the conditions of deprivation, the condition of deterritorialization, the conditions even of poverty, out of that, experiencing that, we try and think of forms of life that are not simply utopian, that don't negate these negative moments, but actually take these negative moments as a learning experience. And the philosopher Avishai Margalit has said something very suggestive, for me at least, in this area, where he says that negative politics often comes before normative politics. He says, it is not justice that brings us into normative politics, but injustice. Not equality, but inequality. Not happiness, but suffering. Not dignity, but humiliation. And so it should be. And as we know, you know, the Convention on Civil Rights, on Human Rights was formed after the Second World War. So there's always this, you know, after these moments which are deeply existentially powerful moments of suffering, often they're inchoate moments, out of that comes a certain normativity. So I thought that might be when we talk about unequal, uneven, or as Saskia Sassen puts it, the global city is the place where people may be powerless, but they have presence. All these moments where the negative and the positive somehow uncomfortably sit together, I think are very, very important for us to think about. So that a show like this is not about a new vision of the whole of society, but it is to learn from the negative, to actually take the lesson, to work with the negative, to create the normative. Now, with that in mind, I just wanted to make some reference, Pedro, to a few of your ideas here, just to throw this open, and then, of course, we can have a conversation. And the passage that I thought might be important for those of you who are not completely au fait with the concept of tactical urbanism, the passage that I thought might be useful would be this. Tactical urbanisms, writes Pedro, may impulsively arise from the streets, but they also emerge from given creative practices and domains of specialization. Spontaneous takes on the spatial reinvention and appropriation of existing urban environments have thus come to combine top-down initiatives with bottom-up ingenuity with different degrees of mutual contamination. And you call this an acupunctural politics of urbanity. The whole city and all of us are lying on this bench and people are putting needles into our pressure points. And this notion of a kind of embodiment of the city, I think, is very, very interesting. So I thought I'd throw that open and just ask a question of all of us. That tactical urbanisms, or the ways in which those deprived of power or those deprived of space and make their own kinds of authority, have to, in some sense, also have to, those spaces are also are creatively generated, but very often governments or municipalities abandon the poor to that creativity. I'm being paradoxical here. They say, these are the conditions, make the best of it. And I think that is also a problem when we want to celebrate this kind of power. I think it is a problem that the state can step back and say, you know, yeah, you use a bicycle, you know, an old bicycle to generate electricity for your favela or for your slum. How creative. It's fine for us to come in and say, oh, how creative. This is almost like a performance piece. But it isn't a performance piece. Somebody has to live with these poor lighting conditions, however creative they may seem. So I thought we might begin by talking about how we set certain norms in this field of unequal urbanities, mm-hmm. where we want to learn from the experience of deprivation. But we do not want to encourage that deprivation and say, be creative in your suffering or in your deprivation. We want to do something else. So what would the norms be? Mm-hmm. And how would we set these norms? And that's why I thought I might start with this notion of the negative as being not utopian, but a certain kind of productive moment in creating the good society.
Mm-hmm. Well, if I can jump in. I think it's, of course, what we were trying to bring, and I think you put it brilliantly, was really the idea that we could conflate what has been traditionally a form of top-down planning that then originated certain forms of resistance from the people trying to, you know, counterpoint some forms of power that are exercised on them. And then situations, of course, which cannot be accepted at a certain level. And here I think we must make a distinction and or maybe a very short history of what you could understand as tactical urbanism. Because I think particularly in the United States over the last years, there has been this notion that these spontaneous actions that people take in the streets into their own hands, almost in a libertarian form, could be a solution for urbanism, which I think aligns with a certain liberal politics of in which the government has no presence. But if you trace back this idea of where the tactical is coming, it's coming from a very different source. And that's the source I was trying to tackle, which is Michel de Certeau, the French anthropologist, in the 70s, talking precisely about a situation in which there is a certain power that is exercised over people. And I must say that in the 70s, there were still a lot more than even today, a lot of dictatorial regimes, there were a lot of colonial regimes still in place. And so what he was talking about was how could people actually resist this imposition of a certain political system, and how they, through the appropriation of their urban space, through play, they actually created a space for themselves to resist. And I think this political entitlement is what I would like to address, not exactly the one that says, you know, tactical urbanism is fine, so we as government, as policymakers, we can retreat, we can leave you to your own doings. So, of course, there is an interesting difference between the origin of the term tactical as opposed to strategies, as Michel de Certeau has put it once, and then the moment we're living now, in which what we see is actually the retreat from a long tradition of top-down planning, and therefore these actions being appropriated for the sake of, you know, continuing with this sort of political retreat from those who I believe still have a role and a function. I think the welfare state was a very important contribution to Europe and the states in terms of providing those a further equality, and now things are changing back again for some reason, for some condition that is, let's say, spreading. So I think we are right at that moment in which we have to question terms, both historically and how they are being interpreted right now. And of course, we have to be very critical about the potential uses of these things.
I'd like to add just maybe another shade of this, which is that with the tactical urbanism, it's not necessarily people, the public taking these spaces into their own hands, but it is actually kind of an artistic, an architectural practice by the designers who are coming up with ideas for this. Maybe there are about three different reasons why. One is that there was just no, I'm speaking mostly about the American context because just being the practitioner here, my personal experience in watching the young architects coming up, there really were budgets for urban space, for projects on a city level, on an urban level, really was being reduced, even in a country like the US, to very little. So there was a kind of, and there is still kind of urge to do something, to make a project. So after 2008, in addition to just no money for these kind of projects, there's also a lack of jobs for architects coming out of university, coming out of graduate programs. And so I think there was an impact on this generation who also, you know, there was just nothing to do. So to practice one's art, to practice one's architecture, it is important to kind of self-initiate a project. So, and being a group of creative people that these new architects were, and they're looking for projects that can have a positive impact on their local cities, their immediate environments. And I think also, finally, just that the situation here, this kind of political polarization between parties also led to inaction. So I think the reaction of making an intervention on a space, whatever scale, is partly a result of wanting to practice architecture without having the structure in place to do so for these last years since 2008. And so I think that's when we first start seeing projects, start becoming aware of the projects, and really seeing it develop as just a method of working.
And there's I think one interesting thing that is already a reaction, because I mean, like 7 years have passed in which people were engaged in these actions, and there are already governments that are trying to learn from those spontaneous actions and having like participatory budgets and so on, so trying to integrate those impulses. And maybe this is the balance that you're addressing, and that I think we are trying to bring to the debate, which is how can you achieve that sort of balance? And how can you learn from those actions so that top-down planning, again, coming back to that classical term, can be reinvented with these techniques? Well, and that doesn't mean a demise of the need for that strategic planning.
Well, I think that's the really interesting thing when you look at this from a planning perspective, that tactical urbanism is really a response by those who need to take situations into their control. And it's antithetical to any kind of strategic planning, right? It's very granular, it's spontaneous, and it doesn't fit and doesn't want to fit some larger strategic consideration. So, for me, when I was thinking about the opportunity of tactical urbanism, that is, is it possible for government, municipal, state, maybe even federal, to create a condition in which those tactical moments are part of a larger strategy? Or do these things just operate at such utterly different levels and such utterly different purposes that the notion of urban planning and tactical urbanism are mutually exclusive?
Can I come in on that very quickly, or do you?
I was just going to say that actually I would make a comparison to cultural politics. Mm-hmm. When we have the national endowment.
In this country, that's an oxymoron. Yeah.
Well, but it's the National Endowment for the Arts, this system of offering a small grant that then guarantees that people can further their financing for a certain project could be a model for also urban intervention. Mm-hmm. So I think we can learn from culture in that sense and think that these actions could have more traction and more impact in the city, because impact is also a question we should discuss in that sense.
Yeah, I just want to say that, Jean, what you said about the architectural profession and its conditions of intervention and work post 2008, and why I think that's very interesting. I want to go back a little bit to what Glenn said and what you said with the Certeau, that there does seem a sense that there's the practice of tactical urbanism as a way of making interventions, but it also brings with it a certain socio-ethical issue. And that is the language of resistance. It is not the language of sitting around a table in a planning commission with people and saying, you know, I want to make this intervention. Please give me the permission to make it. The courage, the beauty even of these moments is that they take the state unawares. And this is something different, I think, from the Certeau. Yeah. And let's look at it in one, the notion of security and surveillance, okay, as it has become dominant in actually not just looking at what we do, but creating the spaces within which we give ourselves permission to do things. I mean, the whole map of surveillance is another map that is set on the city. The question of security. So I think that we are in a moment where certain freedoms, of almost anarchic freedoms of tactics that de Certeau talked about, were based on a very different notion of the subject and the citizen. And I think we can't talk about tactical urbanism, or I think in talking about tactical urbanism, we have to talk about citizenly practices. Who is the citizen? Who is deemed to be the citizen? Who is kept out of the domain of citizenship? Who is the alien? Who is the stranger? That seems to me to be as much a part of resistance and the ethics of the tactic as anything else. And indeed, when you look at that, and I'm I can hardly think of anything at talking today after what we have seen happen around over the Mediterranean, the Libyan, you know, what is called, I think, in Europe, the wave of death. These 200,000 migrants over a period of, like, what, 4 years or 5 years? I may be wildly wrong here. Trying to look for a terra, for a place, for a territory of safety. And they're either pushed back or they're put in camps. So I think, you know, when we talk about the tactics of urbanism, those are the issues that I also want us to be able to confront. Because I think that the Certeau idea of who is the citizen or who is the flaneur or how you make your interventions is different from what from the kind of powers of security, surveillance, migration that we confront today.
I mean, of course, in the scope of the exhibition that we prepared, which, as some of you may know, depended on inviting teams to reflect upon a certain issue through workshops, brainstorms along a year, the idea actually was much about empowerment. How can you create empowerment through design? How can you involve citizens in decisions? How can you learn from the actions that have been taking place? And then how can you integrate the idea of empowerment through your design practice? And in fact, there was a subtext for the exhibition, which was sort of mapping new tendencies within the field of architecture and how people are shifting also their positions in regards to what is a traditional image of the architect as a service provider. This idea of self-initiation of projects is quite new for architects. Architects are not artists. They always waited for a client to come. But when they decide to trigger a project, they're shifting their own notion and presence in society. And precisely by just asking questions, we were trying to see what kind of tools could come up that would help thinking a different future, a future that hopefully would not be as dystopic as what the data tells us at this moment, which is, for instance, that not only, you know, as we know, most of the populations will be living in cities, but also that 2/3 of those urban populations will be poor. In 30 years, 2/3 of the people living in cities will be poor. And this represents the inequality that we've been speaking about, taken to an extreme. And therefore, can we anticipate how we will deal with this? This was the type of debate that we're trying to instill. And I remember talking about technologies and social media. How could you integrate those into planning strategies that, in a way, would allow for more participation of the people? Because it's a natural movement that is happening. People do participate through social media in the public sphere. How can we integrate that into design decisions? And I think many actors in the field are concerned about that and are slowly attempting to integrate those ideas into how they can design the space, public space, namely, because that's probably one of the stages where these confrontations become more obvious.
I think, you know, it's not a surprise, perhaps, that 3 of the 6 cities you looked at were sites of Occupy moments, right? Yeah. And that the Occupy movement here in New York, and I think we can't ignore it. On the contrary, we need to think and study it and understand it and deal with its underlying issues. But it was, you know, just one of 3 different, Hong Kong and Istanbul,
Rio,
and the others. That frustration, that inequality, that torquing of whose city it is, the rights that you were talking about, Homi, it seems to me they all coalesce in these moments. Mm-hmm. And those Occupy movements, which have a political context, strike me also as being fundamentally about a tactical urbanism. Yeah. They're about reframing critical parts of our city and resisting all of the orders that we want to establish for normative behavior.
One interesting example, actually, was filmed a few days before the exhibition opened in Hong Kong, precisely, in which you can see in a video how the students, in a matter of days, took hold of public space to create their own offices, their dormitories, and so on. And they took the street and transformed it into an interior space, which is a very interesting operation in regards to the right to the city. And so actually these things were happening because I think the pressure is there. And I think the debate hasn't been enough also in terms of, you know, addressing these questions. I mean, people are compelled to take action, to do these movements, you know, riots in Brazil that took an urban, a very strong urban expression. But at the same time, I feel, and I think that's why we decided in the museum to go for this theme, that the debate was not yet there in the media, namely. I mean, we don't read that much about, or we didn't 2-3 years ago when we started preparing this project. There wasn't that much discussion about this urban inequality, as then even it became a theme for mayors and so on very recently. Because I think the pressure was there. It's like a boiling.
One thing that I think we couldn't ignore with this discussion is really to zoom back out to the strategic urban planning is really the issue of infrastructure and how we think about infrastructure, how we thought about it 50 years ago, but how we maybe think about it now, and how is it possible to think about systemically about the city if we are only looking at it through the lens of the tactical. And as you said, it's not meant to be standalone, but what is the mechanism for thinking about these larger issues, for the pressure that is on infrastructure, not just roads and bridges, but also water and
sewage.
Social
or
infrastructure and sewage. Yes. So, and those things that take really much more regional thinking and systemic thinking to come about. So is there a way, maybe you could speak to, do you think that there's a way that this tactical urbanism, as seen in the show, could ultimately impact bigger projects like that?
Well, I would relate that, and we discussed this a lot during the preparation of the exhibition with the different teams. I would say that even infrastructure maybe has to be rethought in terms of how agile it is. Because we think of infrastructure like, well, imagine landlines for phones. They were the infrastructure that we needed 50 years ago. And Africa has actually gone over that and started using mobile phones. So the infrastructure was no longer needed. So can we imagine that sewage can go in the same direction as mobile phones? Can we actually reinvent that, learning from the informal?
Well, and that fascinates me. How would you assume that sewage lines, I mean, that really does interest me, coming from Bombay, where the whole city smells of shit much of the time.
I remember discussing these with someone about Cairo. In Cairo, there is a system of tunnels in the city that is unused. Could you imagine that using recent technology, you could actually create points in which the garbage would be not collected by trucks, but by these conveyor belts under the city? So this is a kind of utopian.
I want to give a different example for that, because I think it's really interesting that there are technologies now that you could collect and turn sewage into power.
Yeah, exactly.
So if you could do it on a more district base, I think is what we're saying, is maybe like thinking infrastructure on a smaller block by block way, power, sewage treatment, waste to power kind of.
But the governance, I think we shouldn't push tactical too far. Yeah. I mean, I really think there have to be some boundaries, otherwise there wouldn't be any traction.
But I want you to talk for a moment, Homi, because you related it earlier when we were just getting ready, about the intersection of infrastructure and sort of self-made urbanism. And you were talking about water lines in Bombay and how critically important, but how fragile these systems are, and how if we aren't able to address immediate concerns, these things fall apart.
Yeah, and I think this also relates to what you say. I mean, yes, we could rethink the sewage system, but this needs huge infrastructural investment. This is a form of governance that takes us right back to the older forms. There are new innovative work, but we need a huge commitment to doing this. This cannot be done
off the back of tactical urbanisms, however creative they are.
But it can take inspiration.
No, I accept. It can take inspiration. But as you know, between inspiration and institutionalization, there are bribes to be paid, there are policy decisions to be made, there is this government. So I think these are the steps that to make this really workable. But no, just the idea, you know, across the road from where I live in Bombay, you know, there is a slum. It is no longer a slummy slum. It has cyber cafes there. It has, you know, light industry, little, you know, various things. And indeed, there's an interesting, I want to talk about this. The heritage people who wanted to move this away to take this whole group of people who are often from the rural areas, who are living urban lives according to rural rituals very often. That's another shadow line that we need to talk about when we talk about urbanisms. There are people leading rural lives in urban conditions, and that has a whole anthropology, a whole ethnography, and an ethics to it. They wanted to move them all away. Now, of course, the wealthy people who overlooked these slums and thought that their lives had come to an end have a kind of mutual interdependence. They have various services in these areas. But the people who live in those areas provide the services. There is a kind of capital accumulation. Their homes are no longer shanty towns. They build them out of brick or wood or something like this. They're no longer just rusted old pipes in which they live as they used to 10 years ago. But they still don't have those infrastructure. They still don't have clean water. So what you were referring to was that this part of South Bombay, people would puncture the water lines and infect them. So you'd have disease, malaria, but people got the water they needed. I'm suggesting that these discussions are all taking place on a very narrow, sharp line of what it means to survive. And if we forget the survival for the creativity, then I think we're forgetting something very essential. That's all I'm really want to say. It's a very sharp kind of edge on which these things. Let me just say one other thing. We talk, I just want to go back for a minute. This is the issue you wanted me to address, and I hope. Mm-hmm. So I just want to go back for a minute. You know, when we talked about Occupy Now or Tahrir Square, yes, of course, these are occurrences or events in the city. But they are interventions for democracy, for freedom, against global neoliberal capital. And then the true power of these things was not that they happened in one place, but that they produced chain reactions. So we talk about the city, but we also have to talk about the ethical and the virtual kind of ideological journey of these ideas. Mm-hmm. So it's about the city, but it's about something other than the city at the same time. I just wanted to make that point. It is very local, and yet at the same time, it's transnational. And that, I think, is perhaps the new configuration of time, space, and action that at least I'm seeing coming out of these discussions.
It gives some hope for democracy, as if we look over the last 10 years, we see how good we've become at capitalism, but how weak the democracy has become. I'm just thinking of Robert Reich or something like super capitalism, where there's just this they're seen as one thing, but they really shouldn't be. The practice of democracy or making democracy, it maybe benefit, as you say, from the chain reaction and the kind of more the scaling up of that activity. Is exciting, I think, as well for public space, because it demonstrates what public space can actually be and why it's important to have it.
Yeah, but of course, every time we think about Tahrir Square, we also have to think about the big square in front of the presidential palace in New Delhi, where women and students went, men and women went to protest against the rapes in that city, and not this government, but the last government actually sent in the police, and these people were removed with force and violence. So, the world is much more uneven than we see it and we think of it. And the fact that the idealism of Tunis or Istanbul or Cairo has also been mired now in ways that big government interferes. So I'm just saying that we need to be aware of what we're up against.
But I'll turn it right over to you, Pedro. But I actually think you can't lump all of those protest movements together, because I think, at least as I read it, what happened in New York was really a conversation about inequality, and inequality as it plays out primarily in the urban environment, and especially in the very problematic conditions of Manhattan per se, but New York writ large. And Gezi Park was really about real estate. It was about changing an essential part of the city. It was a resistance to a kind of poorly thought through development that was all about creating capital for a small class of people and the loss of public space for a large class of people. Whereas I think Tahrir Square and even Hong Kong were about a different discourse. They're about a different set of problems. So,
yeah, absolutely. And I just want to make that clear. There are the ideas behind these things, and the aspirations are different. Yeah.
I would like actually to go back to this opposition between creativity and the need for survival.
I mean, it's not an opposition.
Yes, of course.
It is not an opposition.
But I do think that necessity is the mother of invention. And I'm not only saying that we should cherish that people are very inventive in surviving. We should rather consider that we have technologies that weren't available a few years ago, that if combined in a very creative way, and I think that's the role of designers and architects and artists and so on, then they can provide new solutions. And they can actually maybe provide solutions for those bigger problems, which also need governments behind them. And we know that investment in infrastructure is also beneficial in terms of economics. So that should not be taken out of the picture. But I would like to give an example, a very simple example, for you to understand how, you know, technologies that are available, that are now made very cheap, can actually be transformative. Think of solar cells, this power and the ability to produce light with just a solar cell. If you provide these to children in Africa that had never had access to electricity, suddenly they can study by night. They can have a light that, you know, feeds on the sun, and this is a technology that was not available 10 years ago. And the ideas that came out of designers' minds to put these different technologies together and then bring it to a place that lacks completely any kind of infrastructure is very transformative for these people. And I think and I have to be optimistic, because if not, I would, you know, shut down, go to the beach and do nothing else. The question is, if we want to be optimistic, maybe we have to believe that these solutions are appearing, and it depends also on creativity, the ability to put them at the service of other clients, let's say. It's not only for certain people. It's really designing and conceiving for a larger part of the population, which is also an important shift. Because if we look at the practice of architecture over the last 100 years, it became, after a period in the early modernism in which there was a social commitment to changing cities, working with governments and so on, increasingly it became about working for a certain sect of people who actually had the economical power to do things, and not really doing much for others. But I think because of the conditions that Jean described, architects who have not access to that sort of client, to that sort of commission, then they have to reinvent themselves. And actually, they find it more interesting to respond to the so-called 99%. And this has been the theme of the exhibition.
It's important to maybe show that the problems, again, with those opportunities, and I think in the design world, there has been a real resurgence of trying to do projects in places that show extreme need or have unsurmountable problems, And I think, you know, in the past, design was always something that evolved slowly, you know, over time. A solution to a problem evolved over time. But in the condition we are now, a post-industrial revolution, we can just design something and have it made. So there are also are many unintended consequences from these interventions that we can, that we sometimes put onto other cultures and other that we don't completely understand. So I think there's also a danger, or aside to maybe the tactical, if it is done without real deep knowledge of who it's serving, can also be a detriment. For an example is mosquito nets that are delivered to Africa to prevent malaria that are laced with insecticides. It turns out that those also are very good fishing nets. So they suddenly started to become used for fishing nets, and they are, you know, having an impact on the food chain because the poisons are now getting into the food source. So I think there's lots of pitfalls as well. I think the positives are really interesting, but they, because we're starting to explore it and saying that this can be scaled, we also have to look at, you know, what are the downsides? And maybe it goes back to the idea that there also needs to be an internal, for every place, an internal kind of strategic understanding of the overall issues. So to protect, you know, frankly, to protect populations from being designed upon too heavily.
Do you want to bring in the environment here? Because it seems to me that's...
resources.
I think the environment is... Well, I mean, in terms of infrastructure, I think it's really interesting to think about these services that can be gained from ecosystem services that can start to work on some of the pollution issues in cities, and at the same time provide public spaces or public amenities. But those are also issues with environment that really need to be looked at from many angles. It can't just be one intervention. I mean, one of the projects that we worked on was trying to understand the impacts of reversing the Chicago River, how it was originally done to save drinking water for the population in Chicago, taking, you know, the water out of the lake and sending it downstream along with the pollutants that were dangerous. But now, like 100 years in, we realize that those pollutants are still harming people just further downstream. So it was a massive infrastructure that, again, unintended consequences on a very big scale. And so as a design intervention more strategic level was to think about and design steps to kind of undo that problem. And that was something that we worked on through a book project in the city and in coordination with people using the river, the everyday citizens, but also in aiming it at the politicians and the decision makers to embrace and
which
enact.
Would not be the typical role of an architect, again, 10 or 15 years ago. And I think that change is really interesting and positive. Because it's about impact, and again, coming back to that word. I mean, one of the interesting things for me about the exhibition and the reception of the exhibition was a lot of people online and so on and in reviews questioning the ability of architects or designers or artists to actually contribute towards change. And I thought, it's like people don't want these agents to intervene and help out. But because it's about just helping for a collective effort. And I think in these areas, like Jean was saying, there has been an accumulation of knowledge about cities, about space, about regional distribution of resources that is very useful. And basically, I think it's only about using that kind of knowledge in, of course, in collaboration, and collaboration is a very important word, in collaboration with policymakers, in collaboration with NGOs, in collaboration with governments, in collaboration with the entities that we've been describing here.
I think, Peter, because the thing that was so exciting about the projects in the show is that there's the ideas are in the form of the physical manifestation. So instead of ideas written down on paper, they are visions that designers and architects can help people see. And I think that's maybe one of the main things about our profession and being a designer and architect is really that to help people envision what the future might be like. And so we're mediators between maybe lots of technical input and literature and philosophy, and we're mediating to the broader the people that and giving them images to look at, giving them projects to experience.
Can I just make two quick points here? I think this is very important. Let me clarify. I'm not suggesting that creativity and survival don't go together, but I'm saying that each of them have their determinants. Each of them have their conditions, and sometimes what we are really talking about are trade-offs, and these trade-offs, these negotiations, we might put it, you know, are very difficult between the insight and the institution. And I just want some of that traction, as to use a word you've mentioned, which we see indeed all around us, to be part of our discussion. But two very quick things. One, you're absolutely right. The work of art, the work of the architect who is the agent of this kind of creativity, is to produce these visions of the future, these aspirational ideas. And I think that is extraordinarily important. But what do you do at a time when urban growth in India, in China, even we know after the recent fire, this huge growth in the Gulf states based on materials which are not safe, we found out after. You know, it seems to me that there is this kind of behemoth, there's this kind of huge juggernaut happening while we are talking about these very important issues, you know, of these interventions, these interstitial interventions are absolutely important. And maybe they become even more important when the general wave is towards these, you know, mega cities being built with bad materials very often, no question of planning. I was sitting on the 50th, whatever it is, 150th floor of some place in Shanghai, and the journalist said, well, what do you think of our city? And I said, I think that this is claustrophobic. I think there is no space here for any evolution or transition. It's all as if it's in one time scheme. You've plonked down a million buildings, which give you a sense of potency. We don't even know what the occupation is like and what the other issues are. So this is one issue, you know, that there is this huge mass on the other side. And I just, as you brought your vision to mind, that is one of the visions that I see too. That's one. The other is called the stinky cheese problem. And again, here I think of my own beloved city, Bombay, in its recent period. I mean, there's no question that the environmental world in which we live in Bombay has declined hugely. You know, whether it's in terms of pests, or whether it's in terms of sewage, or whether it's in terms of convenience or traffic congestion, it is really declined. On the other hand, as an urban and cultural environment, it fizzes, it scintillates. And I call this the stinky French stinky cheese problem. The more it smells, the more delicious it becomes, like a good mature French cheese. And this paradox fascinates me. Many cities are in this condition. They're falling apart, and yet there's huge cultural vitality. And I just wondered what my friends here and here think about this. Living conditions are more difficult than ever before. And yet the imagination soars.
Why don't we turn it to some of you? There must be questions. You can respond to Homi or ask a question. Yes, right there. And just speak loudly, because I don't know if we have microphones that will reach you in time.
Political urbanism and these issues of polarization, politically fueled, sometimes ideologically fueled, but always been there. It's just a matter of when and to what degree of intensity. And in a nation like this country, where we do everything possible to maintain individual power, individual rights, and states' sovereign rights on a small scale level, we're sort of procrastinators in the sense that we get in an urban environment. We're a stronger centrality of ideas, a stronger centrality of property, of creativity, and of power, ultimately, is necessary to drive these changes and to increase the public good collectively. Just I think that's, we were sort of procrastinators. We let it get to the last minute. And then we spring into action, and so the spontaneity with which you were to what you were referring, I think reminded me of the spontaneity. We can argue how much that's an action or a reaction to something else of Emma Goldman, of Eugene Debs, of William Jennings Bryan, of the populism movement. Because 1906, for example, we had in New York City the most immigrants of any year in United States history to this country, and they all just waves and waves, from 1880 to 1920, but 1906 being the peak. And what did we do? We had a stinky cheese problem, right? And we were so crowded, but somehow, Haymarket Square, Chicago, but these things were happening. There was no particular ideology that ran across all of it. William Jennings Bryan was plenty racist, as a populist.
Deep inside that observation must be a question.
Yes. My question is, do you see that? My question is, to what degree would you say that could apply, despite all the technological differences, as a parallel on a grander scale, and applying that? And do you think that we can look to the past in a situation like this and try to apply it in a feasible, or at least partially feasible, way?
Pedro?
Well, there are several questions and angles in which we could go there. And one question is that as part of the investigation towards the exhibition, we have discovered that actually there were presently conditions that were not very different from the Lower East Side at the turn of the 20th century. So there was an invisible slum in New York, now placed in Queens and so on, where immigrants are still flowing in. So the problem is still there. And I think there was certainly a flux in which, the quality of life and the idea of amelioration of going to the city certainly got better during the 20th century, and then suddenly at some point started to decline again. So something went wrong, definitely. And surely we can learn from the past, but the difference maybe, and this is one of the reasons for us to start this project, is that there is a fundamental difference when you talk about like slum clearance at the beginning of the 20th century in cities like London, Paris, New York, and now. Is that the economies were driven by industrialization at that time, so there was the power, the numbers of population that allowed for that action to be effective. Nowadays, it is impossible for governments to deal with the growing slums. They're not stable slums. They're growing slums by the day in situations in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia. So the condition is very different. And what has been discussed, which I think is interesting, is that we cannot address those problems in the same vein as Le Corbusier saying that, okay, this is not clean, this is polluted, so we should tear down all of these parts of the city and just build these pristine buildings, which led to the housing blocks that we now see as a problem. So the question is, how can we actually use that energy that you mentioned, typically in Mumbai, it's the case you see upstairs, and make it develop so that there are better conditions, but that energy is harnessed and is being, how can we envisage a way of using utopian ideas, visionary ideas, to have that city evolve by itself with its inhabitants in a way that I would say resembles, and everybody understands these, how, Italian cities that we now see as very beautiful, these medieval cities, imagine them 500 years ago. I would say they were as infected and as polluted as certain parts of Mumbai are today. But they evolved to become these beautiful cities that we now admire as models of traditional classical cities that work because they provide these connections like Jane Jacobs has investigated and so on. So I think the great achievement at this moment is that we finally got rid of the idea that the way we can deal with slums is just by raising them, bulldozing them, and substituting them by a new central business district. And this is already an achievement, I would say.
Did you want to say something?
I just wanted to say that's absolutely right. But one of the problems is that there is also a maintenance now, that the slum has also developed, but the slum profoundly lacks the kind of right to the rest of the city. Mm-hmm. It
That's
lacks that. And then there is there's a kind of a informal contract between those who use the services of the slum, the more wealthy, the more well-resourced. And there is a very delicate balance. So the slum is not in a way that it is productive, but its conditions of life are not improving. And this, what frightens me is this stalemate will continue because it somehow, suits.
Well, it's worse than a stalemate because it perpetuates a kind of asymmetrical distribution
yes.
of a whole range of rights and goods. So
I
you
go
talked
with
about
that.
Cultural citizenship. Yes. Those slums essentially, especially the ones that are still growing rapidly, they're self-contained units. So
yes.
there's movement out to service,
yes.
movement back, but all of the benefits of
exactly.
that the city has mm-hmm. to offer are precluded.
Absolutely.
And I think the same is true when the slums are invisible, like they were, or as they exist even in places like the larger New York area, yeah. right? So, the slum has a way, and I know that's not what you meant, the slum has a way of being romanticized.
Yes, exactly.
And I think it's just the
Which
opposite.
Is not the point that yeah. we should go for, yeah. totally. But I would say that there is an important point that, for me, came as a realization as we were opening the show, which was that, at this point, we actually don't have a solution to these problems. And this is a hard mm-hmm. truth to hear. And this is why we had to start the debate. Because we don't have solutions. I mean, and even the politicians that say that they have the solution, they're just boasting. They don't have the solution for this problem currently. And this is why we have to start, because I think it will still, even if the technology is faster, even if we now have some achievements that are important, it will take time to understand what kind of solutions we can bring to this.
We'll turn to the man in the white, then the young woman to his left, and then there's somebody over here. We'll get to all of you. So, yes, be succinct in your...
And I certainly shall.
Oh, sorry, apologies. but be succinct.
It's all the same. Wow, what a great discussion. The thing I'm having the most trouble with is I have yet to hear... Where does business come and fit into this? I am increasingly disturbed, frustrated, for lack of a better term, I've given up on government. I've given up on NGOs, frankly, because I think they're in cahoots. I look at business, I look at entrepreneurship. I heard you speak, ma'am, about this younger generation of architects that's coming up, and I noticed this in this younger generation, this millennial generation, coming along, that they're so much sharper about picking up where is the margin, where can I come in and solve that problem, where is the place between the art and the survival. And I think about Brooklyn in the 90s and how the artists moved out of the city and into Brooklyn, into Williamsburg, and then pushed out even further into Bed-Stuy, into Brownsville, and so forth, turning over, creating urban gardens. There we had a graffiti problem. Government was the problem with the graffiti problem, that this was art being created. This was, the 5 points that gets torn down. Government is the problem, often creating the stop hold. So where is business? Where do we take these ideas, the solar cells? Where is the business idea for that that takes that? If the push isn't for making money, true capitalism we don't have, and it doesn't really work anyway. So how do we find the way that the pursuit isn't so much about money, but the pursuit is about a general sense of happiness, that we all look for something we can take from. There's growth there, that there's something to be made from that. Yeah. That's not succinct. Anyway, there's
all right, where's business? Is there a role for business in this?
I think that that's a really good observation, and that that the revolution that is needed is really in understanding the way that things get made. You know, so for the last number of years, we have just kept moving things to places that were cheaper to produce items in a around the globe, and you can see the path of where the tennis shoes are made and where the iPhones are made and so on. And so I think the real breakthrough that might help this situation would come from figuring out how to decentralize production of goods, so it would work kind of like it works with services, that co-locating people who want jobs that are in the service industry and people who want to hire people in the service industry, but a co-location of the making of things together with the need and demand. And I think that the technology, not the technology is solved, but I think it is about on the verge of being able to transform into something that's decentralized and more local. And that might help with a business model, might help to get that going, and that would feed into a better urban condition as well.
Do you want to take that up? I just wanted
to add that there's something you talked about, interests that are playing out in the city, and of course the tension between these interests creates much inequality, but also creates at certain point the creativity of the city. But I would say that one thing we rarely refer to is self-interest. And I think people have to have a self-interest in taking certain ideas that we've discussed here as business models. So when we talk about the solar cells, like you mentioned, there's someone that doesn't want to do this just because she's being generous, but because they see a business model there. Because again, like Microsoft did, and we know it's addressing millions of customers, let's say, instead of two or three. So there's a business model there. So people have to understand that even if they address the idea of sewage, there may be a self-interest there in economical terms. There could be a business there that could be highly efficient because it uses the technologies that are available, and that totally changes the face of a city, even where government is actually so poor that it cannot respond to those questions.
You know, I think, if I might just say, enlightened self-interest, of course, is absolutely central. But in order for it to be enlightened, and that's what I thought your question was about deep down, in order for it to be enlightened, I think there has to be something that we have actually, which we lack. And it's a very big problem, and it's a very elusive problem. But there is a kind of lack of a social compact. That's what I think. That's why I think to bring this down back to questions of citizenship. And by citizenship, I don't mean want to fetishize who is a citizen, which then allows us to say this one is an alien, this one is sans-papier, this one is deregulated, and not at all. I'm talking the most general, like cive, like civilization, like citizen is part of that larger idea of belonging to a place and collaboratively construct. I think we don't have that. I think that there are many reasons. And funnily enough, certain forms of technology which enhance networking also preclude the coming together in a dialogic condition. So I think that's something that we really need to talk about. And the other issue that I think underlies all of this is the status of civil society in any particular moment. And of course, the struggle of civil society in this moment is to do with something that is very important, which is security. I don't poo-poo it. I don't think security is only surveillance. I think we all want to create that kind of happiness. You do need the institutions of security and the institutions of rights. And that's what post 9/11 is being negotiated within civil society. So I think to rethink how we might bring into civil society new ideas, new interest groups, new modes of representation, that's absolutely crucial. I think, if I might say so, I think that's the kind of underlying issue in your question. Not simply business models, but what creates this enlightened self-interest. And what creates that enlightenment has to be, I think, something to do with public virtue and the common good. And that's something we don't readily have access to.
Your question.
My question is somewhat related to that question because I'm really, really intrigued about the phrase you keep using about, I think you said this and it wasn't me, putting creativity in the service of survival.
Yeah.
And if anything, in my opinion, of course, if there's a tactic that could be broadened, and perhaps even institutionalized, if that doesn't undermine the whole purpose of a tactic, it would be that. How can we put, with architects, for example, because you mentioned that profession, how can we put architects' profession, their creativity, in the service of survival? And one of the ways to get that empathy, the need for that social compact might, I was thinking about architects as ethnographers, is they travel to the slum in Bombay that you talked about. They travel to wherever it is and they live there in the place where survival is very difficult and use their creativity not just for functionality, not just
but
for...
But this is happening as we talk. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is happening with thousands of younger architects that actually had to engage with those sorts of practice. Sorry for interrupting.
Mm-hmm.
And also, there was an interesting reaction from a very important figure, urban think tank, the people from Caracas that studied this idea of acupuncture in terms of urban intervention, that they were saying, you know, many people are not aware, but even in terms of professional opportunities, at this moment, there is a lot more to be done with NGOs in different locations, and people are starting to discover that they can actually have, you know, self-fulfillment, they can be more creative, actually, by joining those forces locally. And this is happening already.
Also,
maybe it's not in the mainstream, maybe it's not so discussed, but Architecture for Humanity is an example that some people have heard of. But I think it's happening already.
Also, I think maybe it's a good point that you bring up of how the creativity comes about. And I think that has transformed also recently to expand the notion of the creative, the one singular creative architect. I think that has gone, and to be creative, we actually need to work with others in many other different fields, as you mentioned, going somewhere, but you might need to work with an engineer, you might need to work with a social service provider, or an NGO, or a scientist, or a community activist to come at these very complex problems. It's really the way of working has changed, and it's really become more interdisciplinary in our approach. So it's really not just about architects. I didn't mean to give that impression, but it's about, you know, like groups of creative individuals with different lenses on each problem.
We'll pass the microphone over to that gentleman. But while you're doing that, I just want to add that you can't remove the issue of business capital, and vision from cities, right? Because at the end of the day, many of the problems we're dealing with are the result of asymmetrical distributions of capital and a vision of the city that doesn't recognize that you have to invest differently if you want a richly mixed, heterogeneous city. And it's not just about the investment in infrastructure. Mm-hmm. It's about thinking about how people live and where they live and what they have access to where they live. And that's really complicated.
Yes. I apologize for my English. some years ago, there was a call for new geographies of theory. So to invent new theories, not in the global north, but in the global south. So there was a call for research in big cities of the global south, like Mumbai or Cairo or Johannesburg and other cities. Where do you see, do you see new theories from the global south coming up? I mean, Pedro said before that we don't have a solution so far, so we are still looking, and it's obvious. But do you see any little baby theory coming up, or
let me add,
you're just talking?
Let me just put a plug in for another exhibition here at the Museum of Modern Art. Up on the sixth floor is an exhibition called Latin America in Construction, 1955 to 80, which is an exhibition that, of course, takes a look at a historical moment when countries from Chile to Mexico were constructing their identities through housing, through the infrastructure of education and the university system, through festivals and events like the Olympics. And so there may be lessons to be learned in looking at the past in addition to those theories that may be emerging today. Pedro.
Well, I think it's a very interesting and important question, which I'm sure Homi has a lot to say about. But my feeling is that there has to be more exchange between these two locations, the North and the South. And I think this is critical at this moment, not only East and West, but also North and South. And I think there has been a dislocation of people from migration, intellectual migrations, let's say, from people going to other places, and this is originating something very new. And I think this is very important, even in terms of India, the fact that engineers are coming to Silicon Valley and then are coming back to India. I think these movements are really generating something new. And I don't know if it's already theorized, but I think there's something there, definitely. And this is one of the reasons why, for us, when we chose the cities, which try to represent different conditions and different stages of inequality, let's say, around the globe, that we were always very adamant at having a local practice, which is embedded in place, which has practices in that city, which knows the condition very well, and then someone that was like doing a global research practice. And it was that interaction that was important. Even if, in the end, they could have been very conflictual and could have, you know, by ideological reasons, for instance, not really engaged in a true conversation, I think what is upstairs could not have been produced individually if you had taken only the local practice or the so-called global practice. Mm-hmm. So I think those interactions in between those forms of knowledge are currently very important. And I know Omi has studied these, and I think this is really crucial. And it talks to me about the idea of an agonistic politics, which Chantal Mouffe has also talked about. It's not about antagonisms from different groups and interests. It's really about how different points of view can start discussing common ground. And I think it's necessary.
The great African-American poet, philosopher, and politician, W.E.B. Du Bois, in 1946, I think, gave a lecture here in New York City, interestingly, to Society for Asian Studies, it wasn't that, but something like that. And one of the things he said in 1946, which is really proleptic, it was about the present, but it was about a future that was yet to happen, and I think that is our future now,
was that the problems of, I'm quoting him creatively, the problems of New York, Paris, London, Chicago are actually not simply contained in their own social or cultural milieu. That in these problems are the problems of Africa, the problems of Asia. And I think what he was saying, and what he then went on to say, was that those who today in our cities are unemployed, those who feel oppressed, those who are unhomed or unhoused, those who do not have access to citizenry interests, belong to the condition of the quasi-colonial. Now, that's in 1946. Of course, the relevance of that to your question is simply this, that I think the North and the South are here. I always say globalization begins at home. I'm not that interested, or I'm very interested in aid given to Africa by the United States, or aid given to Afghanistan, contentious issue. But what is, for me, what is really important is how are those marginalized, minoritized, whether they're national minorities, whether they're sexual minorities, how are those populations that articulate different forms of difference, how are they being treated at home? Globalization begins here. You don't have to think 6,000 miles away. You have to think here, here. And therefore, I think the North and the South have now formed a very complex tryst. There is a very different kind of relationship. One way of thinking about it is in the mobility of populations. But another way of thinking about it is more virtual. You know, for as many people that move, there are many more people that don't move, that are in a particular place. But the technologies that we have, the permeation of the atmosphere now with the possibility of reaching out, means that there is a continual hybridization of what is inside and what is outside, what is external to your conditions and what is internal to your conditions. So I think what's really important now is that kind of what I've called possibly not very elegantly vernacular cosmopolitanism. Not a kind of cosmopolitanism of sovereignty and power, but a kind of cosmopolitanism that you learn from everyday life and the foreign or influences, the external influences that embed themselves within it. And therefore, I think that theories today, that this is actually an optimistic scenario, because theories of emancipation, theories of justice, theories of liberation go beyond, at one level, nation-state interests or interests of specific communities, perforce, because the conditions in which we live are conditions of a larger kind of vernacular cosmopolitanism, if I've communicated something. It is, as I say, not a cosmopolitan of sovereignty. It's a cosmopolitanism of survival in difficult and complex situations. And I think that should give us hope. And that would make the United States here in Manhattan as powerful a place to think about the intersection of North and South as would be Nigeria, or as would be Bombay, or as would be Karachi. So I think that, you know, the situation is both more hopeful and more complex than a North and South division. And indeed, in every northern city, there is a South.
There's a question here, and then we'll take one from up in the back. So yes.
Very much interested in the concept of survival vis-a-vis, just the energy and creativity brought about by the daily survival of the indigenous local people. And I guess the concept, the prototype I came to this lecture, the talk initially was the prototype of, you know, this Chinese inventor, completely uneducated, very interested in improving, you know, local people's condition. I think he was from Hunan province. He devised a scooter, electric scooter, that has a electric motor, but it's the prototype is actually a suitcase, a very cheap suitcase you can buy from, you know, the local market, and I think it was very cheap. You can basically get the final product for around, he made it to be around 100 RMB, which is about, you know, 20, less than 20 US, so the local people who do not have the money to buy a scooter will be able to afford something like that to commute to work. I don't know if it was finally approved by the government or not, but the invention was there and it was very inspiring. I also know this other case of a Dutch architect who came to China, and for certain areas that are very dry, the climate is very dry, he devised certain public sort of street furnitures where it collects water for public usage. But these are very different sorts of prototypes because the agent of the creativity is different. One are the people who are local, indigenous, who suffer through the plight of their situation and was driven by necessity to invent. There's a raw energy in there. And the other are sort of a more sort of interventions from outside. Oh, you know, I see you're living in difficulty. I'm trying to help by providing technology, necessary knowledge that, you know, local people probably do not possess. But there is a sense of, you know, imposition in that kind of intervention. And the two different agents, I feel like, is an issue that needs to be addressed. I don't know how much, Professor Bhabha, how much importance you put on that kind of distinction, or do these two group of agents should just collaborate to make it work? The other reaction, more like a comment that I have, is for the stinky cheese metaphor that you raised, which I found very pertinent, especially in the Chinese case, which I'm more familiar with. When you have, you know, these China scholars, people who are generally interested in China, going to cosmopolitan cities like Shanghai and Beijing. I remember there was an article a few years ago by someone, you know, who wrote in the New Yorker saying, I've seen a place that's more modern than New York. His plane was descending into Shanghai, and he felt, well, I've never seen anything like this. So there is a sense of energy. There is a sense of almost utopianism in the face of this energy. But in contrast of that, as all of you pointed out, there's these slumming situations, the local people who don't check into Park Hyatt, as the New Yorker contributor, but rather, you know, live down in the slums and dangerous streets underneath. So there is a contrast in there. And my question, I guess I want to make it brief, is my question is in this stinky cheese scenario, is more energy necessarily a good thing? Or as, you know, people who are visiting from outside, when we go to these places, we see, witness these energy, are we aestheticizing it? You know, see it from a lens of beauty and even visceral pleasure, rather than sympathizing with, you know, the actual conditions on the ground. Thank you.
You've
created a new metaphor for us, the stinky cheese city.
I think both your questions are very pointed and pertinent. Let me take the second one first. Yes, there have been occasions where I have felt that there's a romanticization of people who are trying to put together very creatively whatever they have in order to make a life of value. I think we have to concede that there is value, there is creativity. But we've also got to concede that many of those models cannot be scaled for a whole community or a whole city or even a whole living domain. They cannot be scaled up. And if we are thinking, as our friend there mentioned, that we are thinking of some sense of the commonwealth, so some sense of the common weal, some sense of a public sense of equitability and purpose,
then we are thinking in scale. We have to scale up. So very often, there is an aestheticization of a kind of, you know, nostalgie de la boue, you know, how people survive. And, you know, in earlier times, it was to do with the primitivity, you know, or the romantic celebration of childhood. You know, there were always these states where you thought people were, you know, outside of the mainstream, and yet they were creative, or yet they represented something which was deeply moving. And so I think there can be that aestheticization. But what I was proposing there was that there are a number of cities where there is deprivation, there is inequality, and at the same time, and it must have to do with a particular time, there is a flaring up of creative intelligence. I mean, you know, property prices have never been as bad as they are in Bombay. Property laws are very, very problematic. And yet suddenly, in the last 10 or 15 years, Glenn, correct me if I'm wrong, there are a whole set of art galleries that have opened up. And these art galleries are not simply tourist, you know, artifact places. These have opened up with the pressure of artistic work. Theaters are thriving on very little, on a shoestring. But compared to when I grew up in Bombay, where there were two art galleries, right? There were two art galleries, Kemmold and Pandole, and then there was the museum, which in those days was asleep most of the time. And in Bombay, if you asked, you know, if people talked about the museum, they actually talked about a bus stop. They didn't talk about going to the museum. It was all now. Wherever you know, in little inauspicious places, you know, almost there is a growth of artistic representation. There is a kind of the basis of intellectual exchange. So I think when I talked about it, I talked about it not nostalgically, but in several places where all the conditions constrain you, there is an attempt, particularly in the realm of the cultural, and in the realm of design and architecture, I would say, to really try and push back against this, against the dominant emphasis in the society. I think that's to respond to your second question. I think this idea of the indigenous, the exogenous, somebody coming from elsewhere, the inside and outside. Here, I don't have very much to say. I would just go back to something I said earlier, that these boundaries are much more fungible nowadays. Not only because, you know, people from outside come in and give their opinions, but because opinions are much more accessible, or views of yourself from elsewhere, the news from elsewhere comes to you in a much more accessible way. So I think that, of course, there are certain kinds of, and I think of building. There are certain building forms now in India that I witness, but of course I see this in China and in other places, which are a part of this kind of neoliberal capital expansion, which are deeply oppressive. And if I might just say, so the solution to them is also very problematic. For instance, now in India, in Bombay certainly, but in India, I think Bombay, because people want to build very high-rise, luxurious apartments, this requires the displacement of shanty towns and slums in that area. At one stage, these people, the proposal was that they should be simply removed, you know, in some way paid off, and they would go away either to their villages or to the far fringes of Bombay. Now there is a relatively progressive but interesting form of legislation that those who lived in that area in poverty have to be rehoused in that area. Now what you find are that you take a drive, you know, up a path, and then you see these very, you know, project-like homes. They aren't the kind of tin and tin and string homes in which many of these people live. They are solid homes, but they're very project-like. I mean, there's nothing inspiring or inventive about them. And then you drive another 2 seconds, and you see a Manhattan-style a building, apartment block, where flats go for anything from $2 million up. And there is this cheek by jowl, this side by sideness. And I'm just wondering how this will develop in time. Because it is not that once they're placed there, they are actually fixed there. There is no sense of a common ground between them. And I just wonder what's going to happen to that kind of modular form.
I think there's a really interesting talk, and it could even be an exhibition about how different cities are dealing with and working with the inequities in income, but with the living space. And in this case you describe with very different building types, but close together, other cities are much more geographic separation, yes. Like a central core and then lower income housing or informal housing way out beyond. And other places are where subsidized units are within the same structure. So I think it's very interesting future study or expansion on this conversation to think about what ways work, and maybe there's different ways for different cities and cultures. But I think it's not necessarily bad in the Indian context to have this tightly knit city between different levels of income right together.
But that only depends, does depend on some other sense of equitable social compact. Mm-hmm. Because when you have these two building types, the people living in the tenements, I'm using a Victorian word, but in the tenements, and that's what they are, all of a sudden find that their supports around them are going. So the little shops, the vegetable sellers, they're all being moved away because you've got to pave a large path for all the Mercedes and all the Bentleys to proceed to the great house. And their whole urban ecology has shifted. And in these cases, I can only see that in time, some developer would make a bid, and they will move. Because it's very difficult for them to be rooted for much longer once they've been displaced.
But you have a good example in New York, which is the fact that housing blocks that were made as subsidized units have been gentrified and they have been upgraded. And now they're sold at maybe not the market price of the luxury apartments, but they're right there. So that process is happening and may happen there, or they may, as I know of other cities, they may implode at a certain moment. They may just implode the tenements and again remove people from
there. That's what I'm saying. So I think this is a very precarious way. This is not, in my view, a model for kind of side-by-side living, because there is no sense of a common interest there.
Let's take one last question in the back, and we'll hope that you'll frame this question succinctly.
Hi, my name's Irene. I work as a community organizer in New York, and I really appreciate this presentation because often as I move through the city, I think a lot about and I try to observe how domestic workers, young children, seniors, and people with disabilities use space or interact, engage with, or maybe don't have a chance to engage with the space in the way that they'd like to. And I guess as you were talking, I was thinking, for me, I have a curiosity about sort of this point of the intention of the designer, the architect, the person who creates the tactical urbanism project, and that space between that and then when people actually come and engage and decide what they will make of it. And I guess my question really is if there are any major trends you see about that space, and also any major trends you see having to do with the lifetime of some of these projects. I think it's often, like when I see some interventions in space, they feel very temporary, but in my community organizing experience, like I do feel Like there are projects that can have a permanence if there was some collaboration with what is going on in community organizing, what might be going on in terms of the government and how it's trying to also rework space to work for citizens.
If I can say something to that, I think there many of these projects are certainly temporary. And I think what they try to do sometimes is not just necessarily inviting participation and, you know, community presence, which they also do, but sometimes many of the projects that possibly you've seen when you entered the room, they are also about raising awareness, a sort of critical awareness of other ways in which you could use the city, and just calling attention to spaces that are sort of lost, unused, or misutilized, and that bring you a new perception of the city. And I think this connects to why maybe we're doing these projects at the Museum of Modern Art. I mean, we're not the city department of housing. We're not actually considering that we can solve these problems. But we can bring it to the cultural realm, again, as a way of raising critical awareness. So the visions you see there, they actually aren't proposed as solutions for the problem. They are part of an artistic vision, like we said here, that tries to instigate these other perspectives on the city, which I think are also lacking. There is a sort of homogenization of how we see the city, especially in the mainstream media and mainstream politics, which I think doesn't attest the vitality and the difference that we can find in the urban tissue in general.
Jean, do you want to add something? The creative voice yeah. should be the last voice.
I think the trends that you're maybe looking for are, the trend is that people are becoming more active and engaged in the artistic community, the architectural community, with the place where they live and work. And partly, like I think I mentioned in the beginning, I think it was partly because there really just was a lack of, you know, actual work for architects. But I think it's also reflects our time where we feel that we can have an impact in our own environment. So I think, and as a community organizer, you would be somebody who would be great to collaborate with an architect or a designer to help draw out of that community what actually would be appropriate. You know, you would be acting like the kind of client, you know, voice. As together with a designer, and that is where I think the trend is going, so that, you know, that the design process is not just isolated in a single individual, but is more of an outreach and a research project and something that's trying to be responsive to the given place.
Jean, may I ask you, sorry.
No, please.
Mr. Chairman, may I just say...
Co-chair.
Give me Mr. Co-chair. Beloved co-chair, may I just ask you to tell us once more something you said earlier on, which I thought was very inspiring, about the river and the boathouses.
Oh,
and
yes.
And by making that, yeah, sorry.
Yes. Yeah, I think, one of the projects that I mentioned earlier about the reversal of the Chicago River that was really more of a research project, not a project with an architectural endpoint in mind. It was really to help bring a vision to the city about its river and to expose some of the complicated issues about it. As what was really interesting about that project was after we finished it and really timed it to align with some policy that was happening about a mandate for the river, cleaning some of the pollutants that go back into the river. So it was kind of timed for a policy thing. But after we finished that and put it on the shelf, about a year later, our city got a new mayor, Rahm Emanuel, and he had looked at that work, that research work, and also realized that the river was something that touched all the neighborhoods through the city as a kind of a back door, not just the front of the city, like the lake. And actually, one of the first recommendations in our book was to give people more access to the river. It was really about, we know it's polluted, we know it's dirty, but as the first thing we should do is to acquire some of the unused property and give public access to it. And that came out from talking to the community members and talking to people in the city. And so the mayor actually decided one of the first things that he was doing was to make boathouses, four boathouses along the river for the youth, public buildings with public programming to give people access to the river. And so it was kind of, for me, it was a really gratifying experience because something that we did as a research, more active thinking project ended up with a real architectural element, and the design of that really acted like almost like a magnet bringing people to the river for the first time. So I mean, it's a great example of how those different scales can start to merge and to create space within the city.
So let us end on a note of optimism, that we can make change, that it always boils down to individuals taking control, being inventive, highly creative, and thank you, Jean, Pedro, Homi,
thank
and all
Glenn.
Of you.
Thank you, Glenn. Thank you.